The following is a presentation of TFNN. The Power Trading Hour with your host, David White. Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-445-1044. Now, David White.
And welcome all to another exciting edition of the Power Trading Hour with me, your humble, lovable, and squeezably soft host. As always, we love to come to you at this time.
The following takes place between 2 p.m. and 3 p.m.
And I thought I had something that was missing. I did. I closed it by accident. So I now am waiting for it to come back up. We're up 21 points at 2760, 93. So let's call it 2781 on the S&P cash, up 205 on the Dow. NASDAQ's up 77. And where are we at on the Russell? Up 6 on the Russell. Crude oil up $1.70. And we've got a few things going on here. We've got plenty to talk about. If this is the only show you listen to today, then thank God. But I will also remind you that Wednesday, the market is closed for the funeral of our former president. And I have no idea. I've sent some emails out to companies that are supposed to be reporting earnings on it. Got no response. Sent some emails to the NASDAQ and the NYSE. Well, what's going on there? How does that all work? Probably, I don't know yet, but maybe the happiest guy in the entire world is the CEO of Google, who was supposed to set to testify on Wednesday. No word on that, whether he still gets to get turned slowly over the spit or drawn and quartered like the last 5 minutes of Braveheart on Wednesday. So, you know, a lot of things up in the air, but not many people asking questions about that. You know, we got a handful of earnings on Wednesday. Do they just continue to put them out at the same time? Do they do other things? So we got a handful of those. We'll talk about those stocks coming up this week. I don't think they're big enough to change the market in themselves, but maybe they could put a little bit of spin on the ball of maybe one of those sectors. And that's about it. Now, on Friday, as we left this show, we were looking for some fairly light volume in the markets. Overall, I tend to use the CBOE consolidated tape that breaks it down, and I have that in every newsletter. I was showing everybody how light the volume was on Thursday, and in fact, it was going to be lighter about halfway through the day. Something happened, then maybe loose lips, maybe everybody was told, but man, was there a giant rush to change the outlook, forward outlook of the market, at least in options, in the very last part of the day. Of course, today starts fund buying. Again, fund buying last couple of days of the month and the first 3 days of the next of the month. So the way that the calendar falls, we've got till Wednesday. Does that push a little people or a few people into buying today or tomorrow? My guess is that if you're in Wall Street, you're going, okay, Wednesday's a day off. I wasn't expecting it. Maybe I buy when we come back on Thursday. It's in the charter for all these funds to buy on a certain day of the month, and about 80% or 85% of them are at the beginning of the month. Opposed to a whole bunch, well, I wouldn't say a whole bunch, but maybe 10, 15% are somewhere else in the month, like the 15th of the month. I haven't gone through it extensively, but I think a lot of those are ones that maybe are more oriented to commodities or bonds or ETFs, that kind of thing, where there's a reason for them not to be at the beginning of the month. So anyway, we've got a lot of stuff going on out here. Now, as we look at the volume today, as I said, where is it at here? Let's find it out here. We were looking at 8.6 billion shares, I think, on Friday, which is normally a very light volume. And we had 3 days, we were in the 6 billion or 6.5, 7 billion range. Today, we already have 5 billion. So there is a lot of volume coming in. Question is, and I saw it right from the open. That was a very aggressive shorting in some names. And I think a lot of people just thought, you know what, we're not buying it. But at the same time, it's very tough now. If you're going to remain short for the threat of an additional tariffs coming in, you got 90 days to roast slowly and then be drawn and quartered like the end of Braveheart. So I don't see a lot of reasons to go short. We are having some fairly decent volume, a lot of unknowns. We'll see these things out over the next few days. Again, this, especially in bear markets, I've seen a lot of people slowly roasted. And sometimes almost like a pizza oven at very high temperatures in very short amounts of time. I remain long in my positions. I kind of picked one out on Friday that, well, it was basically break even. And it was up maybe 1% today, so I'm not going to get too excited about it. Some of the other ones I was in were up 5% earlier, somewhere in there. We were looking for a bottom and quarter in copper. We talked about that last week and even talked to Larry about it on his show briefly out there, that it was a good Gartley pattern. We'll bring that back up. We've got a little bit higher in some of these things, some of them flat, some of them a lot higher, some of them kind of rolled over. We'll look at a handful of these on the chart, see if there's anything big to be made. I don't think that there's a lot of money to be made in ETFs. I'm not in any of those. In individual stocks with high short interest, where they slowly turn the heat up until everybody decides that they have to cover, there's a nice short squeeze, and normally that's where you want to get out of it. Now, it's not uncommon, especially for the way that this market's setting up, for a lot of people to think about doing something at the first of the year. I do not see any reason to be short this market before the first couple of days of next year. There's just nothing out here. Volume's going, even though it's not today, is going to severely start shrinking over probably, I'm going to say, starting Thursday. Maybe it's going to be the next big volume day of the year. And then from there on, probably going to see a fairly decent pullback. When we come back, we'll be talking a little bit of history. Then we'll get into some charts. We'll get into some answers from some questions. You can always email me at path@tfnn.com or call me at 877-927-6648.
The TAS Profile Scanner is the most revolutionary piece of trading software that you will ever try. Wouldn't you like to approach the markets with confidence? As you begin your trading day, it's likely that you'll be faced with lots of decisions. In order to make the best decision, the first thing you'll need is a strategy that will help you minimize your risks. Whether we're in a bull or bear market, a good strategy is to have the tools needed to help you scan and analyze the markets before you trade. The TAS Profile Scanner instantly scans and filters over 2,500 global financial markets, such as stocks, ETFs, commodity futures, and Forex. Headed by Steve Dahl, president of TAS Market Profile, the TAS Profile Scanner understands that in today's technological world, the use of top-flight software applications, automated trading algorithms, and technical analysis expertise is essential to successful trading in today's market. Whether you're looking at the trade matrix, the ETF heat grid, the market breadth, the landscape charts, or the many other features of the TAS Profile Scanner, this is a piece of software that will revolutionize how you look at the markets and set up your trades. The team at TAS has even put together a 12-part video series to walk you through every aspect of the TAS Profile Scanner, which you can find directly on the TAS order page at TFNN.com. Sign up now for only $97 a month with a risk-free 30-day trial so you have nothing to lose and everything to gain. See for yourself how you can harness the full power of the TAS Profile Scanner by visiting the front page of TFNN.com today, and you'll find the TAS Profile Scanner under the Services section. Remember, with a 30-day money-back guarantee, you have nothing to lose. Don't let another day pass you by without trying out this amazing piece of software that will revolutionize how you look at the market and how you place trades. Sign up today.
Many of our new listeners have heard about The Tiger's Den. The Tiger's Den is a lively community where professional traders and investors can meet, exchange ideas and information in a comfortable, moderated atmosphere. Hear all of the TFNN shows, plus see all of the charts as they happen live and have access to archives of all of those charts. You can test drive The Tiger's Den absolutely free for 30 days and greatly enrich your knowledge of these markets and how to make your money work for you. Details on The Tiger's Den are on the front page of TFNN.com.
TFNN has launched our brand new website. You can still visit us at the same TFNN.com URL, but when you do, you'll see a new and improved homepage with a much simpler navigation, whether you're watching Tiger TV live in high definition or just accessing your newsletter subscriptions. We even have new pricing in 6 months and yearly options. Check out the new TFNN.com now and experience all the upgrades. TFNN.com, educating investors.
Call now, toll free at 1-877-927-6648. Internationally at 727-873-7618.
And it's all just a little bit of history repeating.
On this day in 1918, we hit a peak, a little over 300,000 dead every single day from the Spanish flu. Most people think about other stuff that happens, wars, everything else. This, at least historically, for everything that we can look back through 6,000 years of recorded history, was the single biggest pandemic. It actually started off earlier, about midsummer, June, July, had a little pop. But by September, many of the doughboys had been coming back to the United States, Australians back to Australia. By the time it was done in the short 2 years, maybe 20 million people had died in the First World War, somewhere between 40 and 100 million. No one knows for sure, because they didn't keep very good records, died in this small amount of time. Now, one of the more interesting things was that these kind of flu bugs tend to have a change over time and evolve. Sometimes they evolve to be more deadly. And that's exactly what happened this time. But it actually changed from the first to the from the midsummer until the fall. The one in the very middle of the summer, where it really kind of took off and then died out for a couple of months, went after the weakest, the oldest, and the youngest. Then it mutated to actually go and directly attack the immune system of the healthiest. One of the reasons why the numbers of people it killed were so high was they thought they were probably immune to the same thing that had killed off most of the children and let's call them old folks. So there was one more bump coming into March And then that was it. It kind of went away. We've continued to study it. Of course, no one knew back then that they wanted to save and preserve this stuff for things going on in the future. But in the past, we really just didn't have that many people moving around the globe because of the end of the First World War. We did. Now it is one of those things that happens on a daily basis. And people at the CDC, this is what scares them, that once again we'd have something like the Spanish flu like the Andromeda strain come back, have one thing and light a fire. There's about three times as many people on the globe as there was in 1918. 40 to 100 million may be a drop in the bucket for the next giant pandemic. On this day in 1918, we hit the high of deaths. I think this chart actually is cases that people got. Took about 7 days for them or longer to die, maybe 2 weeks for a lot of them. Anyway, that's at least part of the story.
Now you know the rest of the story.
Let's go ahead and get to some charts out here. The first question I had today was, why was Discovery Holdings, DISCA, getting hit so hard? Why I didn't deal much with the front office of broadcasters. I did deal a great deal around them, and they would wander by. People in the technical side of television is what I dealt with, from being in offices of CNN to all the great big broadcasters, QVC. They all had our equipment that we manufactured and designed in their store. I didn't have that much to do with them. I would tag along, though, to look for ideas for new products, which is really what I did. But one of the things I did find out a great deal about with hanging around the people that did sell to these is how much money these stations were willing to spend when advertising was good, like in the year of a election where people were spending a lot, and when they were not. Now, the question came in on why was Discovery Communications being hit so hard. In fact, there is right now, at least I've seen some other articles about football rates, even though the actual viewership is up slightly over the last couple of weeks, the rates continue to rotate lower. My thought instantly was that that generally when you see rates on something like football or TV shows start heading down, it heads down for literally everything. In fact, you get a lot better ratings for football because people watch 90% of football or 95% of football games when it actually occurs. We've since TiVo, we are now one of these folks that record all our shows, but we do not watch them. The rates only apply if you watch them within 3 days of their airing. And if you hold off and watch what's going on the TV or you record your show like whatever it is, I don't watch Discovery anymore. It used to have some neat stuff. Kind of boring now, in my opinion. If you watch like Fast and Loud and some of the other stuff that they have on there, which is kind of poor in my opinion, you watch 5 minutes of it, figure it out. The question is whether or not they're going to watch it in 3 days. And if they don't, they don't get credit for it. And the rates go down. With football going down and other things going down, I suspect a lot of people are recording these shows, not seeing them. And we're seeing kind of the continued degeneration of the values or the rates that advertisers can actually change. There was some happy talk from the CEO today. But again, this is just one of these things where, especially as younger folks come along that never have watched commercials at all because all they've watched is Netflix and YouTube, they kind of maybe know commercials from YouTube, they're quick to bypass those in a number of ways. Or just not pay attention to them too much. But certainly what we see in Discovery, I suspect is a long-term trend, and that is pay advertising based on 42 minutes of every hour being content, and the other 18 minutes being advertising is going away. I have a feeling that by the time they figure this out, that the we're probably going to be more like 10 minutes of advertising for every 1 hour of TV to bring viewers back who just aren't used to sitting there and having 2 or 3 minutes or 4 minutes go by, especially people like me that like to watch other long-term movies now. It's just jarring to get anything like a commercial. I don't watch football, so I'm sure that that's the one thing where people will go to the refrigerator and get a beer. Anyway, Discovery Communications ad sales. Down, down, down.
The Path of Least Resistance, David White's daily market letter, gives you trade recommendations based on David's proprietary power law vector indicator that put the odds of success overwhelmingly in your favor. He'll give you the entry price, price target, and stop price for each stock and option trade. David combines his years of trading experience along with his background in technology and computing to offer his subscribers his take on the markets on a daily basis. Every trading day by 9:30, David publishes his morning issue of The Path of Least Resistance along with updates sent out throughout the week whenever there is new actionable trading information. All new subscribers receive a 30-day, no-questions-asked money-back guarantee. To sign up for David White's daily trading newsletter right now, visit the front page of TFNN.com and you'll find The Path of Least Resistance under Trading Newsletters.
Hi folks, Tom O'Brien here. If you'd like to get my daily newsletter, Market Insights, then now is a great time to sign up for a 30-day free trial. Every morning by 9:30, I send out my morning letter to subscribers with market commentary on a variety of markets, currencies, and commodities to keep investors up to date on the day's trading action. Included in Market Insights are specific buy and sell recommendations for stocks, ETFs, and even options, with stops and price targets included for every trade in my newsletter. If you'd like to try my newsletter risk-free for 30 days, then head over to the front page of TFNN and you'll find Market Insights under Trading Newsletters. I use my years of trading experience to bisect and dissect the market every morning and give my subscribers the most important information they need to know for the day ahead. I even issue afternoon updates for my subscribers whenever warranted with important market action. I'm always scouring the market for the next great trading opportunity. Sign up for your 30-day free trial to my daily newsletter, Market Insights, today by visiting the front page of TFNN.com. Wow! Go get them, folks.
TFNN is excited about our new software charting program, The Art of Timing the Trade Charts. In collaboration with Tom O'Brien and using his best-selling book, The Art of Timing the Trade, Your Ultimate Trading Mastery System, David White has programmed an outstanding piece of software that will complement any trader's methodology. Using this first-of-its-kind program, The Art of Timing the Trade Charts allows you to scan thousands of stocks for Fibonacci formation setups, including Gartley's, ABC's, Butterflies, and much more. The Art of Timing the Trade Charts is designed to help you when scouring the markets for stocks just beginning to form the trading patterns that many investors spend days, weeks, or even months searching to find. And right now, we're offering licenses available at only $79 a month. We are so confident that you're going to love this new charting software that will even give you a 30-day unconditional money-back guarantee. Don't miss out on this incredible new piece of software. Get your copy of The Art of Timing the Trade Charts today by visiting TFNN.com.
This segment is brought to you by Think or Swim. For more information, just click the Think or Swim banner on the front page of TFNN.com.
And we're back. Last week, we talked about COPX, the copper miners, Gartley pattern. And there haven't been a lot of good ones. They're not symmetric or a lot of energy on the downside from the C to D. Copper was one of those that was different. We saw a huge move in the copper miners today, just something to watch out. If you're going through Tom's book and looking at Tiger Gartley's, I don't know if Tom would say this was one. I would, but certainly when I use my power law vector indicator, it's one of the reasons why I pushed this out as one of the textbooks to watch, and that is that the energy on the C to D was about half of what the energy was on the X to A. And that's exactly what you're looking at. Very symmetrical looking pattern out here. Now, when I talked last week, I think it was on Thursday and continuing to Friday, I said I never believe in coincidences in the stock market, especially when they start screwing with data with all the bad ticks and everything else. Well, it took me a while to figure it out on Saturday and rewrite my software to work on the data and also to scrub the data for all the bad things that the bad men had put in it. You can say that, you know, maybe it was just a normal occasion, but it's almost always that I see moves that are fairly significant when this occurs. So, you know, if you go into a restaurant, have the same waitress every day, and she gives you an extra dollar back that she shouldn't each day, you think, well, maybe she's a little dopey. If she takes a dollar every single time, then, you know, she just likes a little extra money and maybe kind of a thief. If it's one time a dollar long, one time a dollar short, probably just lazy, doesn't want to count. So if it's always a dollar to their side, I don't think you can give them the benefit of the doubt. So I figured something was up. One of the biggest things was the way that they were able on Friday to push options out. A lot of people don't know how to read options expiration charts. I've been working on it, of course, since 2004. And what it really was interesting to me is how these folks didn't think that, at least in the SPYs, SPY, about 274 was the smallest or lowest these guys thought the market would be on December 21st. And about 280 was the highest on Wednesday. Man, did these guys run it out. They now have very little money to the upside. In fact, it doesn't really start until you get to about 288 on the SPYs. And what does happen, though, is every bit the market goes up, a massive amount, maybe 200-300 million, could be lost on the downside from puts. And this is exactly one of the reasons, and now we've got it backed up with some data about why I do not like being short going into December. This is not to this extreme, but this is generally the way that the market lays out. The premiums are very high for a while. You buy those calls, and the premium shrinks every day as the market goes a little higher. If you're not in a stock that has some massive short interest in it, basically the decay overwhelms the small moves up you get day after day into the end of the year. And this basically says that they, until they get to about 288 on the SPYs, they're not really worried. They think that's kind of the in the most extreme view of the world, that's as high as it would be December 21st. See if we have anything else out here for emails. Somebody asked me why I suspected last week that we were within 2 or 3 days of a big bounce. I think I had that phone call on or email on Wednesday. I was looking at, let's see here. I was looking at my sector oscillators. And we were looking at OIH. I think we can find myself. We continue to push lower out here, but we'd started in basically an uptrend in the oscillator. And again, I was suspecting that we were going to continue to make higher lows in this after it has now basically been washed out. I'm going to be doing a webinar, I don't know, sometime in January. Now that I've had these out and in the newsletter every day for a year, I was reticent to scream and yell and go nuts on these. Anybody can make something that looks very good in retrospect to make a lot of money and or see efficacy going forward is a totally different thing. I finished most of my work on the first year. I want to thank Basil Chapman for helping me and looking at these every day and giving me constructive ideas on how to go after it. But this is my first project that actually uses machine learning, or at least machine learning concepts and algorithms and thoughts to come out. I've got more stuff that I've been working on that'll be coming out probably fairly soon. But we'll be doing a webinar for my subscribers of both the Tech Insider and this. We'll talk about how we and how extensive the use is on this. But again, and we're going to bounce probably maybe 55 on crude. What is it right now? I didn't even look. I think it was $52 last time I looked. 52.79, up $1.86, which is about 3.6%. And one of the things I did come out with and was emailing back and forth with Basil last night is how my charts are these sector oscillators can actually pick when the chances of more than a single deviation from the expected norm movement of a sector can be looked. And a lot of times you'll get three or four. These will point out when you can get three and four times deviations from the expected norm. We're going to go through that. But basically, this says, hey, when you got aces, you put a lot of money into the pot. And that's basically what it is. We can give you times when the risk reward becomes incredibly great, and other times, or most of the time, you're sitting somewhere around in the middle, and you're not just going to get maybe a one standard deviation in the sector. But there are times, and now we can point that out mathematically, when you can greatly figure out that you've got a much better hand. And hopefully it's not aces over eight and you're sitting in Deadwood. Give me a call at 877-927-6648. Well, we're almost out of time. We're going to get to a few more charts in the next segment. We're going to answer a few more questions. Yeah, we got plenty of time here. We'll get into some charts and look at some of these FANG stocks as we have those requested.
Are you in the market for buying or selling real estate in the Bay Area, including the surrounding St. Petersburg, Tampa, and Clearwater markets? Tiger Real Estate LLC is a firm that has extensive experience in the Tampa Bay Area. Whether you're looking to sell your current property for maximum value, or you're in the market for a second home or investment property, Tiger Realty has the experience across all areas of real estate in the Tampa Bay area to help buyers and sellers make the most informed decisions across all price levels. From the price you should be paying per square foot in certain up-and-coming areas to the type of cash flow investment properties are capable of creating, Tiger Real Estate can help you make the best decision when it comes to all areas of the market. Before you make one of the biggest decisions of your financial future, call Tiger Real Estate LLC today at 727-329-8322 or email us at tiger@tfnn.com. That's 727-329-8322. Call us today.
No matter what kind of trader you are, 2018 is a great time to try out a subscription to Tom O'Brien's Gold Report. Whether you just plan on diversifying your portfolio with some exposure to gold and gold mining equities, or you're a gold bull that sees 2018 as the year of commodities, now is a great time to sign up for the Gold Report. Tom O'Brien publishes his Gold Report every Monday morning before the market opens and covers a variety of topics, including gold, silver, platinum, copper, the XAU and HUI, the dollar, bonds, South African rand, as well as more than 20 of the most actively traded mining equities. Start your 2018 off with a bang and sign up for the Gold Report today. The Gold Report is a long-term newsletter where the focus is on building real wealth through the management of a successful portfolio of gold stocks. For all the details and to start your subscription right now, visit the front page of TFNN.com and you'll find the Gold Report under Investment Newsletters. Will the S&P 500 continue to climb? For bold trades on U.S. large cap stocks in either direction, trade SPXL, SPUU, or SPXS. Directions Daily S&P 500 Bull and Bear Leveraged ETFs. Direction Leveraged ETFs. An investor should carefully consider a fund's investment objective, risks, charges, and expenses before investing. A fund's prospectus and summary prospectus contain this and other information about Direction shares. To obtain a fund's prospectus and summary prospectus, call 866-476-7523 or visit directioninvestments.com. A fund's prospectus and summary prospectus should be read carefully before investing. An investment in the funds is subject to risk, including the possible loss of principal. The funds are designed to be utilized only by sophisticated investors such as traders and active investors. Distributor Foreside Fund Services, LLC.
Don't forget, you can listen to TFNN live on your mobile device 24 hours per day. Go to TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV. That's TFNN.com, then hit Watch Tiger TV for the latest market information.
And we're back. Question about where Apple could go. 50% retracement takes you to 195. 196, actually. If you got 618, it takes you to what? 202. I would not be surprised to see this thing hit 200 bucks, just because of the sheer number of shorts in this and the games that we know that Mr. Buffett can play. He's a big owner of this and, of course, has the biggest both options and broker. Backside where he can manipulate stocks as he wants. And one of the easiest ways to get rid of stocks, if you want, is to cause a nice little short squeeze. But I would say 195, 196 would probably be a fairly decent point to take a look at this one. It may, you know, you're really going to hit resistance at about 193, 194. But if, again, you're thinking that the end is nigh, we're going to make an ABC down on Apple, I think you'd probably want at least at this point to get a 50% retracement before you went bonsai on this. What else do we have? Boeing, of course, the big stocks like Boeing that had a lot of people betting on the end of the world. Now has more energy on the way up from this November 20th low than had on the way down. Again, I'm not a big fan, although you would have made money in this one. I'm not a big fan of shorting stocks that are virtual monopolies. Apple, you know, can you make some money? Yes. Can you make a lot more money on a stock that's literally broken? The answer is yes. They go to none, like GoPro or a lot of the other ones. They've been so transparent, though, that it's hard to get into those stocks because they have such high short interest in them already. But we've got to, 5 million shares already going into a 4 million share high in Boeing. So if you're looking for these, this is not the weakest stock out there. Of course, this got a little help from the Lion Air issues. A few more things about the weekend on whether or not where the blame is to push, and it ended up being the giant finger, fickle finger of fate, was actually pointing at Lion Air and their failure to install an optional blinking light. Is it still immensely strong? It's good. It's one of the better ones out there. I'm not going to say that it's going to go back up to its high 392. But I do think that it could hold out here from 350 up to 380 through the end of the year, and maybe a 50% possibility of testing that 392. There's a few monopolies that are as good as Boeing now. Intel is kind of one in the server business. There's a handful of other ones. But there's just not that much to go wrong at Boeing. They can get a Lion Air every once in a while. They're almost always quickly forgotten. A bigger issue for me would be Apple into the new year. If they're very late to the party with a 5G phone, it becomes problematic for a while. Could it still bounce? Yeah, people, they have kind of a short memory for what's going on. They'll think Apple's got some kind of magic thing going on. The magic in Apple, though, may be another year down the pike. I would say that of these kind of almost monopoly-like positions in the marketplace for their products, I'd much rather be in Boeing than Apple for the next 6 months. But that's it. Now, Microsoft continues to be one of the best-run companies in technology. Again, yeah, kind of a bounce up into the previous high. On Microsoft, it is lighter today. You had 38 million shares on November 7th. We're only seeing so far about 22 million shares. So figure we get to about 30 million shares. But energy is about the same on the way down as the way up. So a lot of these stocks that a lot of people thought were going to blow out the bottoms that had, Microsoft does have about the same volume at this $100 level from October 30th to November 20th. So I think you can make a case, not for weakness in these stocks, at least not yet, but you can say that maybe these things are, and some of the best companies are in trading ranges that I do not expect them to really break out of soon. Could you get 116, 18 before the end of the year in Microsoft? I think you might, as it continues to have a bigger market cap than any other company in the world, bypassing Apple. And of course, number third now, Amazon? We didn't look at that yet. Okay. Now, Amazon, going into Christmas, a much bigger issue. We did break through the confluence range of, 1644. Is that right? Yeah. To 1660. We blew through that this morning back up to the previous high. Right now, you got 5.4 million shares going into 6.5. So actually fairly decent volume. Now, that's from the highs. Now, what you've come back through here is, of course, these huge down days in late October. But those seem to have been kind of wiped out. Energy to the upside. Amazon actually has more energy by about 15-20% off this November 20th low. That November 20th low also had 10 million shares, right, compared to, let's call it 11 million shares, compared to 12.5 million shares. So it was a little lighter. I still say that you can see at least some elements of a giant price range. But this is a fairly giant price range that is from 2050, all the way back down to 1420. But you are and have gone through that confluence range today with some gusto. Don't get to use that word enough, but certainly some gusto. So that probably the bottom side of that range now is 1650. And my guess is you'll probably get up back up to 2050 sometime next year if something doesn't, if they don't get thrown in the hooscow for monopoly practices. We'll see what else has on there. Checking on my inbox, question about Hubs, H-U-B-S. Okay. Up on lighter volume, gave it all back. You've got a couple of gaps down that you were hitting. You also had volume in the range of 700,000 shares on the downside. Friday you had 480,000 shares today. Went higher on just 345,000 shares so far. Again, you're back into this big candle, 900,000 shares. So, yeah, I don't see a whole lot in this. This, again, a lot of these stocks have now set up a lot of patterns that look like some fairly large trading ranges are in spec, and you're kind of at the very top end of that range. We'll look at the next one. I think that's Quantiles, QLYS, when we come back.
I'm certain you are or strive to be one of the best of the best at everything you do in life. It's the most common trait that we tigers and tigresses share. If you're looking to become the best of the best when it comes to managing your money, let me teach you to do what most wealth managers tell you can't be done, which is how to time the markets. I'm Steve Rhodes, author of Mastering Probability, and for the last 12 months, Timer Digest has been tracking my newsletter signals, which have earned me the ranking as their number one market timer in the nation for the S&P 500 for the last 12, 6, and 3 months. Timer Digest also ranks me as the number one market timer for gold as well. The fact is, markets can be timed, and I'll teach you the exact set of tools that I use that has transformed me into one of the best at what I do. Sign up for Mastering Probability today by clicking on the newsletter tab on the homepage of TFNN.com and get immediate access to workshops where I take you step by step how to use an extraordinary set of tools as well as provide great market calls too. Sign up today.
David White's newsletter, The Technology Insider, is focused like a laser on finding the next big things in technology. If you had invested only $10,000 in Microsoft in 1986, you'd have been a millionaire by 2000. Disruptive technology like Microsoft's is the key to these massive long-term profits, and The Tech Insider is the vehicle from TFNN to capitalize on these opportunities. This is the go-to newsletter that identifies, monitors, and profits on mostly little-known cutting-edge companies with great long-term prospects. David's experience is as an inventor of Emmy-winning animation products for TV and Hollywood that propelled a company public. Match that with 14 years as a full-time trader, and he's uniquely qualified to guide you through the light-speed world of ever-evolving high-tech. If you're ready to ride the next big technology bull market for less than $40 per month, log on to TFNN.com and get your two-week free trial to the Technology Insider. Get in on the ground floor of the next big thing today. Since 1984, Basil Chapman has been using the Chapman Wave methodology to advise traders of his expert market opinion. While originally hand-drawing charts from the late 1970s into the 1980s, Basil noticed that prices under most circumstances virtually always had a certain number of legs to the upside before declining sharply. Later, Basil found that computer software, which included the standard market technical indicators, enhanced the degree of accuracy in calling price turns as well as market trend calls. Thus was born the Chapman Wave sequence. Using the Chapman Wave methodology along with other indicators, Basil Chapman advises his subscribers of his expert market opinion each market day with his opening call newsletter. Right now, you can get a two-week free trial to the opening call, Basil's daily trading newsletter, by visiting the front page of TFNN.com. Cancel at any time during that trial and pay absolutely nothing. Get your two-week free trial to Basil's newsletter, The Opening Call, today by visiting TFNN.com.
Catch Tom O'Brien, professional trader and educator, founder of TFNN, also a special guest on CNBC. Tom will bisect and dissect the markets. The Tom O'Brien Show, next on TFNN.
And we're looking at Qualsys. Now, see what we have in that. You basically got to the 50% retracement in this today. You're holding it. Volume's okay, at least compared to the last 3 days. This one looks a little better. The question is, what are you doing? Energy's okay. It's not great. Looks to me like if we continue on, you could continue to see, what is that? 86.19 is the 618. But again, a lot of these things do look, you had a little bit more energy on the way off the September 13th high all the way down to this November 20th low. My guess is you're going to consolidate a little bit more. But again, a lot of these stocks really have set up some really wide trading ranges. You got three attempts up here at the high. You made a fairly good signal up here that you weren't going to make it. First high on June 14th was $97.75 with 1.2 million shares. Then you test it with 471,000 shares on July 24th. You don't even quite get there with 324,000 shares. So this thing gave you a lot of signals at the top that this thing was ready to roll over. So you really don't have a high volume high to go after. That being said, I think this kind of has a nice setup and ring you could drift back up to 96 bucks in just a bigger trading range, but that's probably first quarter of next year if things keep going along. Somebody else said something about Qatar and everything else, and just my first reaction to it, I've for a few years thought that probably one of the better business has been shipping, bulk shipping of natural gas, as everybody and their dog wants to export it, the U.S., the rest. To me, that seems like a better long-term bet than the fluctuating price of natural gas. As long as it's low, though, and the more that people produce, better business it's in. So when you can, not when you have to, we will see you here tomorrow. Same bat channel, same bat time.
Larry Pesavento has just started his brand new service, Fibonacci 24/7, and he's already delivering content to his subscribers on a daily basis when the market's opened and even on weekends. Each Monday, you'll receive Larry's written report that provides detailed commentary and a summary on the charts and videos that Larry sends out. And throughout the week, when warranted, Larry will send out via charts or videos or both the key markets that he is watching during the day. This will be up-to-the-date active trading information that will help you in your daily trading. In Larry's first week alone, he sent out 25 charts, 6 videos, and a full report to his subscribers in just 1 week. If you're a technical trader that uses patterns and retracements to trade, then Larry's service Fibonacci 24/7 is something that you must try. Right now, new subscribers can get a full 30-day money-back guarantee. With nothing to risk, sign up now to Larry Pesavento's Fibonacci 24/7 by visiting the front page of TFNN.com under Trading Newsletters.